When your heart is broken down, 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 and your head don't reach the sky, take your broken wings.
Good day and welcome to the Momentum Metropolitan Career Expo. I am Nkosinathi Mahlangu and will be your host for this afternoon. We are very excited to have you join us today as we carry on with the virtual Career Expo brought to you by Momentum Metropolitan. This afternoon, like any other, is filled with growth and plenty, plenty of opportunities for the youth of Mzansi. That is you. Definitely, that's you, you and you, and obviously you right over there. Today, we're going through to sharing skills development opportunities. That's one area that I'm very much passionate about, and I know you are also looking forward to knowing what's in store for you today. So without further ado, let us give a warm virtual welcome to Advice Dibane and Victoria Pule from our Skills Development and Transformation Unit to share with us all the opportunities within skills development. Advice, over to you and welcome.
Thank you very much, Mr. Nathi Mahlangu. My name is Advice Dibane. So I look after group skills development. And I must say that I'm excited and humbled, you know, for given this opportunity to share with you aspects around skills development and I believe that we are going to have a great conversation around skills development. I think the structure of today's conversation is as follows. I think part one, we'll talk about the overview, which is the landscape from skills development point of view. And then part two, you know, we'll share a lot with you around career opportunities that we have across the group. And then part three, it will be learnerships, you know, what types of learnerships do we have, in particular, you know, employed learnerships and unemployed learnerships. So exciting, more information around that so that you know exactly, you know, before you join the group, you know, what types of programs do we offer, and even after, when you have joined the group, you know, we still have other opportunities or learning interventions in the form of learnership that you can also, you know, gain a lot of knowledge and experience, you know, across the group. And then part four, you know, the internships. So we'll share with you the types of internships we have and those that are on offer as we're speaking right now. So looking forward, I'm sure, you know, to hear a lot more around that. And then part five, of course, bursaries. In the past, we had fees must fall and all of that. So we have, you know, a dedicated port, you know, where we offer financial assistance. So we'll share a lot more around, you know, how do you access the port? How do you apply? You know, are there any qualifying criteria? You know, we should be talking you through around that. And then the last one is the skills programs, as well as the special projects. So we will be sharing with you around types of special projects we have in skills development. So there's a lot that you're going to gain and a lot of information that we're going to share with you. Skills development is a critical element, you know, for growing the country's economy. And one would ask why, you know, simply because we need skilled people, you know, so that we can have skilled labor. And once we've got skilled labor, you know, we will ensure that everyone, especially youth, you know, will participate in the economic activities of this country. You know, that is the whole, or that is the main objective, you know, so that we can have, you know, a new client, we can create more jobs, you know, we can have a new taxpayer. And at the same time, you know, we aim to reduce unemployment and reduce crime. That is the whole objective. And I must say, if you look at last year, you know, our our country's economy was shrunk or contracted by 7% in 2020. And we also saw unemployment rate rising to 32.5% in the fourth quarter of last year. And I must say, as I'm speaking now, those figures, you know, have now changed, you know, have now increased following the unrest crisis we just had in KZN province and some part of and in Gauteng in certain part of the areas. So I must say that, you know, it's really concerning, you know, that we actually need to have, you know, or we actually need to accelerate a recovery and particularly in industries that contribute significantly to the country's economy. For example, you know, in insurance industry where we operate in, the banks, the tourism industry, the hospitality and other personal services, you know, those are the industries that contribute significantly to the to the country's economy. So, and skills development is one of the most effective ways to enable much needed growth, simply because, or maybe that is the reason why, you know, Momentum Metropolitan is perceived as a group, as a good corporate citizen company, which means we take care of the environment where we operate in. So Momentum Metropolitan, you know, invest over 50 million rand on learning and development to upskill directly, you know, diverse people in our country. And I want to say that our investment in youth development through bursaries, internships, learnerships, and other skills programs are the most important element of our talent development program. So our development program requirements have been consolidated into a holistic view of skills development plan for the group. And I'm pleased to say that, you know, in 2021, you know, we trained over 840 young people who participated in learnerships, internships, apprenticeships, of which approximately 49%, and that equated to about 314, were Black young people. So our training programs include, but not limited to, the following, you know, short-term insurance, long-term insurance, wealth management, financial planning, generic management, call center, medical claims, and so on and so forth. And it is with great pleasure, you know, to announce that this year, over 155 learners offered permanent employment at the end of the internships and the learnership program. So it is exciting to say, you know, as part of the recovery plan, you know, we are really investing, you know, in skills development of this country. So during the current tough economic climate, you know, of COVID-19, MMH remain committed to the required skills development targets for unemployed youth. It further aims to create a sustainable environment where learning and development is prioritized, with the understanding that a diverse skilled workforce impacts positively, you know, to the business objectives. So I think that is, in nutshell, you know, an overview in terms of skills development and where we are, you know, as a country. As you can see there, 50 million, you know, have been invested in training and development, and over 840 young people were offered training on different programs. I think in nutshell, I'll hand over to Victoria. Victoria will then, you know, take you through the career opportunities at Momentum Metropolitan and other, you know, exciting programs that you you would like to apply to the group. Over to you, Victoria.
Afternoon, everybody. My name is Victoria. I'm Victoria Pule from Metropolitan Division. I'm happy to be a part of the expo, and I welcome everybody, and hopefully you're going to leave here being able to gain a lot of information in terms of what is it that you can do. And also remember that It's not only going to be from us, you can work anywhere else with the opportunities that we're going to be discussing with you guys. Each and every sector, each and every company, they do have these opportunities. All you need to do is you need to Google, you know, you can find that in there. So, which is very important in terms of you need to give it time. You need to make sure that you are hungry enough and you look for opportunities on the system. I don't want to always say to my learners, I don't want to hear anyone saying that I don't have an opportunity. I'm not working. I'm not doing anything. Things are different than in our time. I'm not going to include my age. Things are different now. You know, you guys have an opportunity to get these opportunities anywhere else in any company, so that you can be able to be upskilled and also so that it can be employable moving forward. So what I'm going to be taking you through is going to be the opportunities that we have with the company. As advisors have said, that skills development is very important. It's a very important element in the company. Skills development is a second core business, you know, in the company, because employees and you guys, unemployed learners, you know, youth, you need to be employed, and employees, they need to be developed so that they can be able to perform in their jobs. So what I'm going to start with is learnerships. There are two types of learnerships. We have unemployed learnerships, which is for the youth. We have employed learnership, which is for the employees. Employees, which is people like us, you know, you can still further your studies, and also unemployed, that is for youth with matric only. No other any academic qualification you need to have. You don't even have to have a work experience, which means once you finish your grade 12, if you do not have funds to go to college, to go to university, or you didn't get a bursary, or whatever the case that might be, which means unemployed learnership is for you. Unemployed learnership, it assists you in terms of you gain those skills, you know, and knowledge within that specific qualification that you would have applied for. Once as you're doing that, also you're going to get work experience that you can be able to utilize after your program. You can be employed externally somewhere else should you perform very good and there is an opening within the company that you're going to be doing the learnerships with, you're going to be employed to them. Unemployed learnership, that is for you guys, for the youth. So you can apply for that. There are different durations within each and every company, each and every sector in terms of when to apply. The positions are applied, are advertised within their company's website and also in the advertising media sites. Adverts are in there. So what we do is that we work with the in-situ, which is the insurance sector, that gives us the window period that, hey guys, we have funding for this and this number, please do apply, and then we apply. Then once they approve everything, and then we do advertise on our website and also on the media side in terms of that. You will see as we go along what kind of learnerships that we have in the company that we run for our sector, because they have to be sector-based and also under scarce and critical skills within the sector. Moving forward, the requirements for the unemployed learnership. There are requirements for both unemployed and employed learnership in terms of what as a person needs to have. For unemployed, you have to be a South African citizen. Unemployed, not working, as I said, not studying towards anything. Why this is very important, because we need to give opportunities to people that have never studied anything. Remember, learnership, where does it come from? Unemployed learnership. That is for people from disadvantaged areas where they are unable to study. There is no funding, there is nothing. That is why government introduced the unemployed learnership. So it is very important that people that do not have any funding means, resources, they are given the opportunity so that they can be upskilled and also have work experience so that when they finish, they get employment easily. Because nowadays, you know, for a person to get employment, they need to be have a full experience. Also, the criteria, you have to be 18 and 35 years old. That is a criteria in terms of the funding works. As I've indicated, only grade 12 is required. And the program runs for 12 months. You have to be committed for 12 months to be on the learnership program, and fully committed and dedicated. Because sometimes as people, I understand that we have certain careers that you want to follow, but because of the funds, you know, you're unable to follow that. But whatever opportunity that comes by, don't look at a learnership and tell yourself that, you know what, this is not for me. This is not a career that I wanted to choose. You will never know where you're going to end up. You have to make sure that you grab that opportunity and run with it. I wanted to be a nurse, but here I am. I'm skills development facilitator and transformation specialist, which is in HR, which I never thought that I'm going to be here. But however, I loved working with people. I'm still working with people. I never look back when I got the opportunity. So I urge you as well that you see an opportunity, grab it with both hands, and then you can run with it. And then you can work towards achieving exactly what you wanted to achieve. So the learnership, as I indicated also, we have the employed ones as well. The criteria runs the same with this one. You will be employed. There's no need for matric because before you get employed, you need to have a matric anyway. So it has to be South African, permanently employed, South African citizen, so that you can be able to qualify for the employed learnership as well. We're going to move towards, these are the kind of learnerships that we have at Momentum Metropolitan. We have wealth management, and you have level 4, contact center, and you have level 4. We have long-term insurance, we have short-term insurance, we have medical claims assessing, we have wealth management, level 5, which is for employees, financial planning, which is for employees. All these qualifications are there. Should you see any vacancy, there is a detailed outline in terms of what is the qualification, what does it entail, and all that. At the end of this, you're going to get all the contact details where you can, you know, contact us so that we can explain to you in terms of what is happening with regard to the qualifications that we have internally, if you just want to have more knowledge in terms of what do they entail. So these are the qualifications that we have. As you can see, they are insurance sector related. So we run qualifications that are sector related only, which is the insurance. We're going to move along to the internship program. Internship program, that is for graduates who have completed their qualification and looking for work experience. Let me repeat that. If you have studied a certain qualification and you need a work experience so that you can have that experience and be employable somewhere else moving forward, an internship program, it is for you. There are different kinds of internship programs that we have at times that are listed there. The requirements are similar as the unemployed learnership. You have to be unemployed graduate, South African citizen, ages of 18 to 35. The program runs for 12 months as well. And the placement, as we have indicated, it has to be in line with our scarce and critical skill for their sector. There are numerous career paths that you can have internally. We have finance, we have marketing, we have IT, we have HR, we have actuarial, we have legal, risk management, customer service. The list is endless. You can apply for those should you see vacancies in terms of that. We work with business where we try by all means as the company to make sure that we give opportunities to the youth when the funding is available. We try to do that. We try to change one life at a time. Whatever number that we can be able to take, we make sure that we do that. Moving along in terms of the internship, we also have the internship for the TVET learners. TVET, remember, that is people that are studying in their colleges. With the internship, that is people that are studying in universities and all other institutions that they might have been attending to. This one specifically, they are for the colleges. People in the colleges, those that are doing N4, N5, until N6 theory, who require in-service training, which is a TVET internship, they require that. That is 18 months placement program. Once they complete that, they will obtain their diploma. So this is what is called the TVET internship, work integrated learning, which means they did their theory on N6, they require the practical part of it for them to achieve that. I know there is a lot of youth that are going through this and they struggle a lot in terms of getting that opportunity so that they can get the experience that they need so that they can obtain their diploma. We try by all means in terms of making sure that we create an opportunity in terms of where we are sitting. As you know, Momentum Metropolitan, we are everywhere, especially Metropolitan, we are everywhere in all the provinces. We are there. You have a need, you are welcome to go to any of our branches. There is somebody that's going to be giving the information and help you in terms of to know what is it that we have and what is it that we can do. With us as a company, as I said, focus is on insurance, business management, financial management, HR, which is going to be in the head office. In the branches, there is an HR. Let me be clear on that. You are not going to get any HR internship in the branches because we are all about sales. It's all insurance. In the head offices, that is where you're going to get an HR. Marketing management, the management assistant. Those are the qualifications that the TVET has. And these are the qualifications that within the sector we look at. Remember, this is an 18-month program. I know there are a lot of youth that have this. Please be on the lookout in terms of this, which is going to be happening sometime soon. Within after August, September, then you're going to be seeing adverts going out in terms of this program. That is unemployed learnership, a straight up internship, and the TVET. Be on the lookout for that. Moving along, we also have skills programs. Skills programs are those short courses that you can do. They are called pivotal programs. This is twice. We have as employees, we do have short skills programs that we run that our employees do attend that they need to do besides, you know, going through the learnerships and all that. Also, the skill program, we do have them. This one, we have them for the unemployed youth. This you will find on our CETA, in CETA website. They do have them. You can even have a look at that. Even after this session, you can look at that. They do have openings for that. You can apply as a youth for a skills program, which will help you. What I try to encourage people, youth, is that please do find something to do. If you can't find a learnership, if you can't find an internship, go to all the CETAs. The CETAs, they have programs, they have opportunities that you can apply directly as a youth. So please do that. Pivotal programs, they relate to programs, professional. P stands for professional, which is program supporting professional enhancement, such as a certification. That is me studying a program that will lead to a certification. Internship, as I've explained, that is work-based experience for graduate and TVET learners who require work experience. Vocational, that is generally vocational programs that is such as your NCV programs. Occupational, that is programs related to occupations, my occupation as a person. Technical programs of a technical nature, as you know, in the colleges, you'll find that. Academic, that is academic programs specifically at a higher education level, that is your NQF levels. Guys, please educate yourself. You all have smartphones, I know. I've done numerous career guidance, and what I found out, the main thing is that we don't know where to go to find opportunities. But you guys, you are able to go to YouTube and Google and check everything that you want to check, TikTok and everything. I encourage you, please Google all the opportunities that you have. Skills development opportunities, you will find them in any company. There isn't a company that does not have learnerships and internships. Please do that. With regard to the qualification that you want to do, you will find something for yourself. There are a lot of CETAs out there. We also have specialized programs. Specialized programs, those are the actuaries, which are mostly based in where advice is based, which is in Centurion and all that. So what you can do, guys, we have a whole team that can be able to explain to you in terms of what the actuaries are, how does it involve, how everything is linked together, what are the qualifications that a person needs to look forward to. There is a whole program. If you go to our website, there is a list in there in terms of explaining what the process is, what is the academy all about and all that. Please, guys, please do that and go through the whole information that is sitting on our website so that you can be able to educate yourself. As I said, that you're going to get all the contact details after all the sessions, and then you can be able to ask us questions in terms of that. You can contact us, you know, in all the other media platforms on that. The other things that we have bursaries. Bursaries that we have, bursaries of unemployed youth, that is bursaries that we you're going to find on our CETA website, in CETA. They have bursaries for the youth that you can apply for, whoever that wants to study something that is sector related. Remember, we are insurance. I will emphasize on that. Each and every company, they have the CETA that they are registered with. So you will get bursaries that are related with the qualifications that are related to that CETA. Please go to the in-CETA website. You will find that. We'll provide you with the in-CETA website information where you're going to be able to find that as well. We have employee bursaries. As an employee, let me say you finished with your learnership or internship. You get appointed full-time basis after a year, you qualify for a bursary. That is where employee bursaries come in. We support you as a company. We want to develop our employees so that they can be the better version of themselves. They can perform better. They can be equipped, you know, so that they can be able to have opportunities, move around in the company, even if they leave, but they know that I was at Momentum Metropolitan, they did develop me. They cared about me as a person, as an employee, to develop me further to achieve my goal. So we have that as well. Don't think that once you are employed, you're going to sit there. No. We're going to develop you further if you want to be developed, because you have to want to know a lot about, you know, to upskill yourself as a person so that you can grow as a person. You cannot sit in one position. You cannot sit, have one mindset. You have to want to know a lot of things that are happening around you and also grow as a person. So that's what we encourage everybody to do in the company. Through our programs that we are having, we had on the learnerships. Learnerships, as I said, that is for the unemployed. Specifically, that's what I'm going to be talking about, the success stories that we have. Success story that we have learnership that is on the contact center that we recruited people last year for the whole year. COVID happened. However, that did not discourage us. We continued with the programs that we had. And I am so happy to announce that all our programs that we had last day, even during COVID, we continued. We had to find new ways of learning, learning through the phones. All our learners have been learning through the phones. Others were provided with tablets so that they can be able to study. We recruited a lot of learners around at that time of COVID. But we have success stories where people, they have completed. Other people, they started as learners. Other people, they continued, converted to interns. Because once you become a learner, if you are really performing, you have potential for the company. If they feel that, you know what, Victoria, she's got a high potential. What they do is that they look at her, okay, you know, you get monitored during the program. Once the program is complete, you get absorbed. You can either get absorbed, be converted, be an intern, go through another program for 12 months. Once you finish that, then you can be absorbed as a permanent employee. So we had, I've taken two people from all the programs that we had. At least two people, they managed to say, you know what, Vix, we are ready to support you. We are ready, you know, to be able to share our story with everybody in terms of how did we come about in terms of being on the learnership, being in Metropolitan, you know, in Momentum Metropolitan, being in here, how did we come about? So I have two people that I'm going to be giving to so that they can be able to take you through in terms of their journey in the company, how they started with the learnership, how did they end up being the consultant that they are. I will start with Lakiwe. Lakiwe, she was one of our learner who was in contact center, started last year, completed. She got absorbed as a call center consultant. I'll give it to Alakiwa just to take you guys through in terms of how was the journey, how did she find the journey, how did everything work out for her.
Hi everyone, my name is Lakiwe and I'm a 21-year-old currently working in the call center at Metropolitan, obviously. So I'll be speaking to you guys about the challenges before, during and after the learnership. So before the learnership, I was doing matric in 2018, I matriculated in 2018. And tried to apply for varsity and it did not work. So 2019 was basically my gap year. In my gap year, I tried to look for like learnerships because I knew if I didn't get accepted the previous year, my chances were just as slim the next year. That was to study for 2020. So in 2019, I came across the learnership and I decided to apply because instead of just sitting and waiting for varsity, I might as well learn and do something for my future. So I applied for the learnership. It was a very great experience. I enjoyed every moment of the learnership. The people were so nice, the facilitators, and like everything was running smoothly. And then the pandemic hit. We started doing online learning. That was the biggest challenge, because sometimes there was load shedding as well. We couldn't do our assignments. Some group activities, whereas when we're in class, we used to do it together in class. So some people are not available, and there was just a lot of bickering. That was the only challenge that I had. It was the pandemic and load shedding. Because if we're at the office, I feel like there wouldn't be much challenges, because before and after that, when we went back to the office, everything ran smoothly. So what I learned in the program is basically to stay focused, because I stayed focused a lot. I focused a lot and made sure that I did everything that I was supposed to do on time, so that way I don't delay my success. So everything went well. I submitted all my assignments and got very great marks, thankfully. And I applied for a post in the call center because it was a call center learnership, and I got the post, and now I'm a permanent employee through the learnership, and I'm thankful for that. Hi everyone, my name is Lakiwe, as you heard on the video, and I'm currently employed in the call center through the learnership. So as I spoke about my challenges, which was basically the pandemic and the lockdown, because we couldn't go to office and we had to stay at home, but thankfully there was other ways of learning. We learned there are thousands of ways of learning through telephonically, on our phones, virtually, and I'm very grateful for that. And basically after that, I persevered, I pushed, and I did amazing. I got amazing results, and now I'm permanently employed. So my advice to you is basically don't be afraid. Just push, take every opportunity you get, because you don't know what light is at the end of the tunnel, and be very open-minded. So good luck to everyone that is going to apply. So I'm taking it back to Victoria. Thank you.
Thank you, Lakiwe. Our success story lady, who was very, 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 always very vocal in terms of what is it that she wanted to do. And she never stopped in terms of trying to make sure that she gets what she wanted. As she had said, that as much as COVID, it is still, you know, a challenge in terms of everything. But on the positive side of it, you know, it taught us to be able to find new ways of learning. You know, you learn through online, you know, consistently full time, and also through your phone. You know, there are other programs that were done through WhatsApp. You know, people were studying through WhatsApp and they managed to pass, they managed to be competent. So as much as it is a pandemic, but the positive side is that now, you know, as people, as also employees, you know, we know the other way in terms of working, new ways of learning, which is a very positive thing. Some other companies, we're still working from home. you know, and the work is still continuing. You know, you find a way in terms of be disciplined, you know, be responsible, you take accountability and be able to do that. And also with regard to studying, that is quite important. And I'm very happy for that class of 2020, which is not the only one. We had numerous learnership. We have learnership that was in Pretoria. We have learnerships in all the provinces. The next speaker that I'm going to be introducing, that is Loyolo Ntleki. This one is a more success story in a way that Loyolo is based in the Eastern Cape. He was on the rural development learnership. We also run the rural development learnership, which is specifically focusing on the youth in the rural areas. We make sure we give opportunities for them, that the CETA, what they do is that they have specific learnership for that. So this learnership, we go all out in terms of making sure that people in the rural areas, they get that opportunity. It gets launched, you know, there is an involvement with the community and everybody within those areas. So Loyolo, he's a product of that learnership that was done in the Eastern Cape. As I said, last year we did recruit. We recruited 46 rural youth in the middle of COVID around June, July. You know, everybody was based in Limpopo and KZN. And out of 46, 42, they completed, successfully completed the program. So these are the, you know, success stories that we see happening, you know, in the company if you get youth that are committed, that are saying, I know what is it that I want, and I know what is it that I want to achieve. So if you put your mindset to it, you will be able to achieve that. You have the support of the company. You have the support of us. You have the support of your mentors. You have mentors that are mentoring you so that to make sure that you complete your program, you understand everything that needs to be done, you know. So if you put your mindset to it, you will definitely be able to achieve it. So I'm going to give it to you, Loyolo Ntleki, who is based in Umtata in the Eastern Cape, to take it away.
A very good afternoon to everyone. My name is Loyolo Ntleki from the Eastern Cape in a town called Umtata. I would just like to share with you my journey with Metropolitan. It all began in 2018 when I saw a learnership advert on Metropolitan Careers Portal, and then I decided to apply. I got accepted on the learnership and had to move to Pisana, where the program was conducted. It was quite challenging for me as I had to move to Pisana and study for a whole year. Then after completing all my studies, I graduated for a long-term insurance qualification and was also selected as a top achiever, as I also managed to pass my RE5 examination on my first attempt. After completing my learnership, I then moved to the Western Cape in George Branch, where I did my practical for about a year. Then on December 2020, after completing my practical, I was appointed in the Eastern Cape in Umtata Branch as a permanent client service consultant. To the youth out there, I would like to encourage them to take each and every chance that is presented to them. Take it, use it wisely, and make sure you put your heart and mind to everything you do. Dedication and hard work will take you a long way. I promise you.
Thank you so much, Sis V, and thanks to, you know, thanks to Loyolo, thanks for advice, and thanks to all the participants for the questions, comments, messages. I think you guys have triggered something here. You have struck a nerve, and you know, in young people's language, when I see what's happening in front of me here, I could only say yo, because it's opportunities galore. And in terms of the questions now, to kickstart the question and answer session, I'd like to direct this question to Mr. Advice Tibane to say, you know, skills development, as we may think the word is self-explanatory, but what is skills development for someone out there who is connected, who wants to know skills development? What do you guys do when you get up in the morning and come to work?
Thank you very much, Mr. Mashango. That's a very good question in terms of, you know, what is skills development? It's education and training. It's learning and development. I think Victoria outlined quite a number of programs, you know, that we offer to upskill the people, to upskill the country. Yes, so it's education and training in nutshell. So we offer a variety of qualifications to upskill, to make sure that people at the end of the program, they have a formal qualification at the end of the day. Thank you very much, Mr. Matlangu.
Fantastic. Thank you, Mr. Tibane. And, you know, in terms of what you guys have shared, you've mentioned, you know, learnerships, internships, and, you know, us as young people, we want to know the difference now. What is the fundamental difference between an internship and a learnership? Or are they the same thing? Please elaborate. I'll take this to Ms. V.
Okay, as I've said that, learnership that is, I'll be very specific, focusing on unemployed learnership. Learnership that is for their youth, you know, you have metric. You don't have money to go to university at home. They don't have money. You have no resources, financial resources for yourself to study further, but you want to study. You want to get a qualification so that, you know, you can move along, start with your career and all that. That is where learnership comes in. Only metric is required. You can apply for insurance in the insurance sector. You can apply at Nestle. You can apply for transport industry. You can apply anywhere. Each and every company that is out there, there is a learnership. You can apply. Please Google that. You will find that. You can just Google learnership. You will find them. Ne? Learnership that is for unemployed youth who needs to be upskilled. And work experience. They get upskilled, they get work experience at the same time. And remember also, as a learner, you get a stipend. You are being paid. So no excuse for you to say that there is no way I'm not working, I'm not doing anything this year. Can you imagine a company advertising, we have a learnership opportunity, please apply. You get paid a stipend, you get paid to study. Guys, please, I beg you. I never had that opportunity. I never had that. I had no one who was telling me that, Vicky, you can apply to be on learnership. I had nothing. I stayed for some time without having anything, without having anyone voicing me and telling me that these are the stuff that you can do. You have that opportunity to do that, guys. Go and check Google as much as we can. I can see lots of you are saying that you don't know where to go. I'm saying to you right now, Google learnership, Google internship. You will find something there on the system. That's what I do as well in terms of looking what other companies are having out there, you know, what kind of learnership that they have. That is a learnership in a nutshell. You are taken through, it's a 12-month program. You are taken through 3 to 4 months theory training straight up. You're not working, you are being taught, just like in university, but the duration is 3 months to 4 months. Once you are done, you are placed in business where you're going to get the work experience. You're going to be trained, you're going to be mentored in terms of that qualification that you are doing until the program is finished. If there is a vacancy, you get absorbed, you work immediately. If not, you're still going to get employed somewhere else because you're going to be having a qualification after that. That is 1 year training, 12 months, you get the qualification. Internship is a person who has gone through college, university, or whatever university of technology. Now you have your diploma, now you have your degree. You want work experience so that you can be employable. Some other people, they are lucky, they get employment immediately. Some people are not lucky. That is where internship comes in. That is the difference. Learnership, you have no qualification, you know, have no academic qualification. Internship, you have a qualification, you want work experience. So guys, please, there is no way that youth can stay and say, I don't have anything. I was in the Northwest and Northern Cape in April for a career expo for grade 12. So we try as much as we can. I know it's not all the companies, but we are trying the best that we can do in terms of, you know, just making sure that we create an awareness that there are stuff that you can do as youth in terms of get that opportunity. I know some of the people are very shy in terms of communicating. Speak to your teachers, find out what is happening. We're going to try by all means to have all the information that you need, even on our website, so that you can be able to check those. So I hope, Ms. Dinati, I've answered that nicely.
Definitely, definitely. That's that was a very satisfactory answer. You have broken it down in its simplest form. Mm-hmm. And as you were going about with your explanation, questions popped up here when you touched on stipend. Is there a set amount on a stipend? Is there a starting amount? Is there a maximum amount? How do we look like rents-wise?
Okay. Each and every sector, there's a difference in terms of how much the stipend is. For example, in insurance sector, unemployed learnership, it can be 3,000, it can be 4.5. So it depends in terms of how much is it, what qualification, what sector are you in. In mining sector, 12,500. So it depends in terms of what qualification that you are doing at in which sector. So it depends. In the insurance sector is 3,000. However, as a company, if you want to top it up, we top it up in terms of you trying to be practical that, okay, this money, what is it like, for example, if there was no COVID? Obviously, people, they need to have transport, they need to do, you know, this and this and this, because that money is not enough, you know. However, that is the money that the government is saying that, okay, we are giving you this actually so that you can be able to go to work, so that you can be able to buy a bus ticket, so that you can be able to catch a taxi, for you to get that education and also get that work experience. The stipend is basically for that. On the rural development, the CETAs, they try by all means, it is like 4,000 a person. Imagine for 12 months, you are getting 4,000 that you are not even lifting a finger and working so hard. All we need you to do, sit there and listen and learn, you know, and get work experience. You are being paid 4,000. Imagine some of your parents are not even getting that kind of money every month. It's 4,000 in the rural development. On top of that, you know, you are given the other opportunities. It's not only that, for example, maybe wealth management learnership. You get a lot of other benefits, other programs. When you finish that, you are nice and ready. You get work readiness. You get class of business, you know, depending on the sector that you are in. The CETA, the tribe, are all means to equip the youth as much as they can. But as I said, we can only do one child at a time. So we try the best. Yeah.
Fantastic. Thank you. And I think it's all about the opportunity more than, you know, the fee. The stipend is helping you to show up. But I think the big picture here is to get upskilled so that you stand a chance of being employed at the end of the line. And the next two questions before I touch on Ulakiwe Noluyolo. Mr. Tibane, in terms of CETA, you've mentioned a lot about the CETAs, and our attendees, our audience want to know, what is this CETA? You've mentioned in CETA, which is in the insurance sector, but who is this CETA? What are they? Where do we find them? What do they do?
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Nati. So the CETA stands for, in fact, it's Sector Education Training Authority. So we've got different CETAs. But what is that? Who is that? So it is a government institution that was established in terms of the Skills Development Act, you know, to oversee training, and learning and development in different sectors of the economy or in different industries, if I were to say that. And in terms of finances, so each and every employer contribute 1% of the payroll cost to SARS, and then that money is kept, you know, as a funding for different institutions, including funding for unemployed and the employee who participate in different programs. Thank you very much. I hope that clarifies.
Fantastic. That clarifies it a lot. Thanks, Mr. Tibane. And back to Sis V, in terms of these learnership opportunities and internships, do you also cater for young persons with disabilities? Because we want to be inclusive as an organization. So are these opportunities available for persons with disabilities?
Definitely. Definitely. Thank you for that question. Definitely, yes. We encourage people with disabilities to apply. We cater for that. And it's going to depend in terms of the what the company is able to accommodate. That needs to be borne in mind as well, because we need to make sure that people with disability, they are comfortable as well. They are included as well in each and everything that we're doing. So when the adverts are coming out, everything's going to be clear. If I still remember that we always on our position, in our position, we always say people with disability are encouraged to apply. They are all welcome to apply. Yes, 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 please. Please do apply. It is very important that you apply. It is very important that you participate. You know, we take each and every person as they are. We look at the person. We don't look at who you are. Finish and clear. So please, you are all welcome to apply.
Great stuff. Great stuff. I like that finish and club part. Yeah. Mm. Yeah, I love it. I love it. And moving on to our success stories now. You came through the ropes. You went through the journey. And today, here you are, you know, being part of the workforce within the Momentum Metropolitan Group. I saw a question here. People were asking, Lakiwe, are you at home? Are you at the office? So where are you, Lakiwe? Are you still employed?
Yes, I'm currently working from home. I am still employed, but I'm just enjoying my comfort at home while working.
Fantastic. And I think working from home, I can imagine it also requires a lot of commitment, discipline, because you are at work and yes. You are delivering.
Fantastic. Yes, that's very true.
That's great stuff. And in the Eastern Cape, Luyolo, Molo Mhlobam.
Openly and honestly, the main challenge was traveling. If you remember when I started in Pizana, then from Pizana, I had to move to Lusikisiki. From Lusikisiki, I then had to move to George. So there was too much traveling involved in my journey, which was quite a big challenge. So I had to go home, stay for a few days. Then after that, move straight to the metro I was supposed to be in. When I was in church, I remember very well, it was not even easy to get a few days leave because I had to spend 2 days traveling, then 1 day at home. You see? That was the most challenging part. Other than that, the hard work and the pressure that I had to absorb was nothing much compared to anything else because I really wanted to be a client service consultant. And that's the only thing that kept me going.
Fantastic. Thank you for sharing those nuggets, Luyolo. As you say, you only live once. Today, we're going to be listening to Naledi Mashego, who comes from Cherry Republic, and she is a founder and a managing director there. And she will take us through entrepreneurship 101 in terms of how to get started should you want to chase your entrepreneurial journey. Naledi, good day, and over to you.
Thank you so much, Nati. And I look forward to having this chat with everyone. So let me get started. So I'm Naledi Mashego. I am the founder and managing director of Cherry Republic, and I run a digital marketing company. So I look forward to going through Entrepreneurship 101 and explaining to everyone how I got here and what you can do to start your business and become an entrepreneur. So today we're going to cover the following parts of the conversation, which will be Entrepreneurship 101, where I'll just explain to you my journey as an entrepreneur, and then we'll get into the entrepreneurship journey, and also just to look at where am I now, so that you can understand how entrepreneurship works. So first things first. As I said, I'm Naledi Mashego, and I would like to actually define myself as a serial entrepreneur because I feel like I'm constantly always looking for business opportunities and always looking for how I can improve my business, what we can add on, and how we can change the business in terms of making it bigger and better. So I think that's also a key factor in entrepreneurship. You can't become complacent. You can't do the same thing the whole time because that's how you get wiped out by the competition. I think a clear example is the Uber and the taxi industry. We saw how Uber came in and literally the taxi industry, for meter taxi industry, was thriving. And they took a market from the meter taxi industry, and Uber is thriving at the moment. So I just wanted to give you a brief background about myself and where I started, because I think it's always easy to just assume I landed up here. But I'm a firm believer in try everything. So before I started the digital agency, I actually decided, oh, okay, let me try different things so I could figure out what do I love, what am I interested in, and what do I want to do. So this is a picture of myself with the real estate company on the left, Hazelmark. So when I was actually at the age of 21, I actually signed up to sell houses. So I was a real estate agent. And I think it was such a great experience. I got to meet so many people. I understood how to buy a house, how property works. And also you get to meet so many people from different industries. You get exposed to sales. I was also learning how to sell because I needed to make sure the houses actually sell. And I think everything I did in my different career paths has also led to who I am today. So I'm really grateful for that. Okay, then after real estate, I worked in the music industry. So I worked at Trace TV, and what I did there was I focused on interviewing music artists, making sure that the channel operates well and the ratings are good. And it was a great experience. I did that for over 3.5 years. In the meantime, I also tried out DJing while I was actually in the music industry because I thought it'd be great to actually try something completely different and out of my element. And that was also a great experience because I always say everything you do, you should treat as a business. So when I DJed, I treated it like a business. I got amazing bookings in terms of corporate bookings. I did a DJ set every Sunday at the Maslow Hotel and so forth. So I got exposed to different aspects of the music industry, and that was really amazing. And then after doing that for 3.5 years, I decided, okay, it's time to move on and try something else because I felt like I had done all I could in the music industry. So I wanted to do something that's more marketing focused. And then I thought to myself, okay, traditional marketing is starting to disappear because at that rate, well, during that time, print magazines were shutting down and so forth. So I was like, okay, let me look at what I can actually start that is also something futuristic. So I actually decided to start a digital marketing business. And initially, the company was called Black Cherry Media. And we only had a revamp 3 years later and just changed the name to Cherry Republic because I actually just wanted the company to have a .com domain, and the blackcherrymedia.co.za and .co.com was taken. So I actually decided, okay, let's do a whole rebrand and go live again. And now Cherry Republic was born. So currently, I started this business when I was 25. And currently, I've been working in the digital marketing industry for over 6 years. This year, on the 23rd of September, the business turned 6, and we've been going strong. We currently have a great complement of staff. I have my art director, Homoto. We have an account manager, and we have a social media manager, and the team continues to grow. So it's a very exciting path that I'm on currently. And yeah, so this is the business. This is just a snapshot of our website. We live and breathe digital, that is us. And I also just put shots here on the type of work we do. So Cherry Republic is a digital marketing agency, and we focus on website development, social media management, and graphic design. So these screenshots at the bottom of the screen just show you some of the work we've done. For example, we worked with Liquor City, so we would do their branding for their store. On the right hand, or actually the left hand side, you see Automat, which is a car dealership based in the Netherlands. So we did the full branding for them, their website, business cards, and so forth. And then social media, that's what we specialize in. So you'll see another company we work with, which is called Daring Adventures. So they're all about travel and booking local destinations, and they're very exciting as a brand. And then on the right here, you'll see the link to our website if you'd like to check it out. So this is a quote I live by. So I just feel if I didn't think this way, I wouldn't be where I am today. So I am a firm believer of no means try again, this time do it differently. And the reason I say that is so often we're told we want to try something and the one person you have in mind says no. Maybe you need to talk to someone else, or maybe you need to change your approach, but don't always give up on your vision because it didn't go according to the way you thought it would go. So sometimes things work out, but not the way you wanted to. And I've seen this constantly in my business. I've seen the opportunities, like I'll try, for example, get a new client in, and I talk to, for example, the marketing manager. But then the marketing manager is like, no, we don't need a digital agency right now. We okay. Then when I end up speaking to the CEO is like, oh, this is a different perspective. We have an agency currently, but we would like you to come pitch and see if we want to have you as the new agency. So it's creating opportunities like that for yourself. You can't just take no and just say, oh, I'm just going to walk away. And being in business is all about resilience. You'll hear no all the time. You have to get used to it and just say, okay, no is not right now. And let me relook at my strategy. And you just need to keep fighting and go for what you believe in. So the most important question for today, which I'm sure you guys would also like to ask, is how do I start my business? So I also wanted to share with you how I actually got my business going and what steps I took to actually get it running. So first things first, just start. I promise you, it's the best thing you could ever do. Stop thinking about, oh, what am I going to do? What am I going to sell? How am I going to do it? You need to say, for example, if you want to sell t-shirts online and you want to brand them, make 4 t-shirts, post those on Instagram, promote the post, make sure people can see it. And you'll find out when you actually get started, do people like it or don't they? Because I find a lot of entrepreneurs or people just dream about, oh, one day I want to start a t-shirt business, or one day I want to start this business. And how I just started is I literally woke up and I was like, okay, I am going to eventually leave my job and start a digital agency. Every time I'd go for lunch or meet someone new, I'd be like, hi, I'm Naledi and I have a marketing business. At that stage, I feel like there was no name for the business, but I started selling the service already because I feel like you have a business when someone wants your service or product. If no one wants your service or product, you don't have a business. So I just focused on testing out the market and saying, who wants what I'm selling? And then when I started seeing the interest, I was like, oh, okay, I have a service people want, but I had to just start and then figure out everything in the end, because that also tells you, should you pursue this or shouldn't you? But also over planning and not acting won't help you understand, is this something you need to do? So this is just to give you a summary of how I personally got started. So I identified a service people wanted. So I looked at the digital marketing aspect and I was like, great, I'm gonna start a digital agency. Then while I was at my full-time job, I actually decided, okay, I'm going into a space where I won't have a salary every month. So I need to financially plan for that. So I think this is so important. I actually saved up. I remember we had a bonus at work. I was already working side jobs. That's also important, like build up your finances. Like it's great that you have your main job, but it's also good to also look at how can you make extra income to supplement your income. And I then started saving parts of my salary, parts of my side hustle income. And then when I felt I was ready, I thought, okay, if my finances are in order and my business doesn't work out, I can still pay my bills. Because I think, to be honest, we all have bills and you still have to adult while trying to reach your dreams. So you have to be smart about how you execute. So the third thing I did was also I looked at getting a laptop, because at the time I had a laptop, but it was actually the company's laptop. So I thought it was important to make sure that when I leave and get on my feet, I have everything I need to be a functioning business. So while I was at the company, I actually still then went and bought a laptop and paid it off. And then when I had my savings in place and my laptop, I felt like I was nearly ready to make the jump. Then the last thing I did was I actually decided to then make sure that I get clients, because I thought, okay, I can't just start a business, but I have no clients. What will that mean? So I then started working hard on trying to make connections and meeting people in the industry, because I thought, since I already had a network in the music industry, let me start there. And then what ended up happening is my first client was Universal Music. And I worked on the Drake and Rihanna album, the digital release of it on iTunes. And we didn't have Spotify back then, but I just worked on the online promotion. That was my first big deal and contract. And then I felt comfortable to actually leave my full-time job and become a full-time entrepreneur. And then I quit because I had all my ducks in a row. Not that it was simple, because I did that. It still was very hard, because as much as I had done all of this planning and I knew that I had some savings, the thing is, you still also have to understand your business, how it works. And also, because I was now a full-time entrepreneur, which I'd never been, I didn't have anyone who told me how to do this. I was also making mistakes. I was I got clients. For example, I had like 5 clients in the year, and then I focused all my energy on those 5 clients. Then, for example, my one client decided to take social media in-house, so they offered me a full-time job, and I was like, that's not the direction I'm trying to go in. So they ended up hiring a social media person in-house and took that contract away. So life happens, even though you have a plan and you need to keep on your toes. So the one mistake I did make was I just kept focusing on my 5 clients and I forgot to build new business. So that was a lesson I learned in the first year of my business. And now new business and hunting for growth is always something I focus on. So business development is always, it's part of my day to day. Every month I'm like, who have we spoken to? Who do we want to attract? Let's get new business on, well, in the company books. And then I also wanted to chat to you about the admin that comes with a business, because I feel people always say, I started a business, but no one tells you how. So I think it's very, very important to just understand the back end and also to see that it's not as expensive as we always think. So the first thing I did after eventually leaving and just getting my ducks in a row in terms of the business is I actually then registered the company officially. I just wrote Cherry Republic, but our company officially registered company name is Black Cherry Media. But I registered that with CPIPC. So you can do it directly. And honestly, the pricing is very reasonable. So for example, for our type of business, because we are PTY, a private company, we paid 125 Rand just to register the business. So you can have a business within a week. It's very simple and straightforward. I also just put the price for NPOs, which is nonprofit organizations, just in case you were looking to register one. They are a bit more costly. They are 475 Rand. And this just shows that it's doable. So it's not out of your reach and there is no age restriction. Anyone at any age, I'm guessing maybe over 13 or possibly less. I'm not too sure on that one, but any age you can open a business. Then the next thing I did was then open a bank account. So I opened a bank account with FNB, and that was like, you just needed 200 Rand. So that was like, great. So it was like, open the bank account, place 200 Rand in there. Then you get your proof of bank account, because some companies ask you before they pay you, they want to know, is your account official, and send us the proof. So then my business was legitimate and above board. And the next thing I did was also then hire an accountant. So you don't have to hire an accountant that is working with you every day as a full-time staff, but you can actually get an accounting business that works on your books, so that you need to make sure that your tax is in place, you're filing every year, because now I no longer was an employee. I had to make sure that my personal tax and the business tax was in order. So in my first year, that was a priority. I made sure I found an accountant who is great, and we're still working 6 years later together. Made sure all my taxes are above board, and then the business was rolling. And then the next thing I also did was then look for an invoicing platform, because you also want to invoice and look professional. So honestly, there's so many platforms out there. I just put an example of the one that I found, which is Zoho. And I used that until I think about 3 years ago or 3.5 years ago. The company has grown, so we needed something more substantial. So we're using Sage, which is a bigger platform and good for business. But you can use a free one. So don't ever feel intimidated by the free apps, as long as you have a professional invoice. And then lastly, I actually then built a website. So I think it's so important to also have a website. And this shouldn't cost you a lot. And it's also something so simple to do. Nowadays, online platforms have so many options for do-it-yourself websites. So I know starting out, like for me, for example, I actually didn't have money to pay like 15,000 Rand or 20,000 Rand for a professional to build my website. But I knew I needed the actual website platform. So I went online and found a free option. But I actually chose to use Squarespace because I actually like the platform. I did pay a monthly fee of like about 220 Rand. But I preferred it because I found it very easy to build my website. And if you use your different website registration platforms, you can actually get a free website, and they all have website builders on it. So you can actually do that so easily and for free. So that's also another option. But there's so many ways to go about this, and don't feel intimidated by the process. So in terms of tips, so I have a couple of tips that I would actually like to share with you, and just to things that I learned during my journey. I also say, as much as I am here now, I'm still learning every day. Every year is a new challenge. I thought, okay, year two, I won't have any problems in year three, in year four, in year five. I find that my problems become complex, and year one was all about just surviving. I just knew all I wanted to do was, I didn't want to be a failed business. So I just fought hard on getting clients, making sure our income is more than our expenses. And then year two was all about building my business. So I think at the end of year two, I actually got staff. Then I had my graphic designer and my social media manager. And one thing I'd also like to say is, like, you want to keep things lean. Because with business comes issues like, you can have a client and they pay late, but you have to make sure you pay for salaries. So you always want to keep your costs as low as possible and take your time with growth. Don't always rush into everything. It's always tempting to do that, but it takes a while. So I just put a few points that I thought resonate with me, and I hope you guys can also resonate with them. So the first thing I said is, try everything so you can find your fit. I think it's so important, like, don't feel judged or like, oh, this is the right way to do things in life. This is the only way. There's so many different ways to achieve success, and understand that success is for you. Like, you need to think about yourself and what makes you happy and what success looks like to you, because we all have different visions and how that picture looks. And I think it's so important to be willing to lose friends and family. I say this because, especially when I was starting out, I had people telling me what I'm doing is stupid, it'll never work out. A previous boss of mine told me, what am I doing starting a business? I know nothing about business, and how dare I even think I'm capable? I had friends, family who's just like, oh gosh, she quit her job. Oh my gosh, it's the end of the world. What is she going to do? It's like, oh, black sheep of the family. So I actually had a mindset before I quit. I decided for myself what I want for myself and what I was willing to do and lose to make sure that I get here. And the funny thing is, like, 6 years later, the same people who had all the negative stuff to say are the same people who are like, sending you messages, congratulating you, and like want to be part of the success part. And I think because I just washed everything out and just ignored it, I was able to focus on just getting here. And I think another thing is you need to understand what you're willing to give up for your dream. So for example, what I did was I knew that my peers would be going out there and they'll be buying houses, buying new cars, but they have a full-time job and they're growing in their career path in corporate. And I had to understand that I'm taking a big step back, but it's because I'm going to make a big jump forward. So I can comfortably say it took me 6 years to catch up with my peers, but I did my 6 years in my own time. And I knew that I couldn't do that stuff like 4 years ago, but I can do it now. So it was honestly so worth it. But I also just blocked that out, stay off Instagram if it's really that bad, and just stay in your lane and focus on you and look at the goal. It really is difficult, but it's not impossible. And another point I'd also like to make is know when to quit and then try again. The reason why I say that is, for example, if you hire someone and you see already in the first 2-3 weeks that this person is not a fit in your business, like call it quits immediately. Don't wait for 6 months for the person to like drag their feet, you know it's not working and you're not making a decision and so forth. So things like that, like small little things, hiring people and you can see it's not working. You sit down with the person, like you don't have to be horrible and just say, look, I'm glad you're here and like it's been great, but unfortunately this place is not a fit for you. And I feel you feel the same. So let's find a way to end it and just do it right. Don't end up in CCMA. And another thing you could do, for example, we tried to expand the business into product. So we were trying to print different things for corporate. So we wanted to do corporate gifting. And I saw the toll it took on my team. We ended up focusing so much on quoting and trying to deliver corporate branding. This is like about 3 years ago. And I saw immediately that's not working. So I decided, no, guys, we're quitting that part of the business. We wanted to try it. It's not working. But I think we tried it for like 3 weeks or a month. And I literally was like, no, this is not working. I wasn't embarrassed to end it and tell the team. We just stopped it immediately and we focused back on our core business, which is social media, website development, and so forth. And then it's also important to understand it takes years to build your business. So you need to like honestly just trust the process, because I think also throughout the years, I was just like, oh my gosh, I want to be bigger already. I want to be already like in different like countries. And I think I learned very quickly in year 3, I was not ready for that. It's one of those where you have to give it time. You have to build a solid foundation and make sure your business works well. Make sure every client that comes in and leaves is happy, not just be like, oh, okay, I want to expand now. So it's learning that time sometimes means 20 years. Time sometimes means 10 years. And sometimes I feel as individuals, or I'm a millennial, so it's like, I'm like time being 6 months. And I just learned it does not work like that, especially in business. Rather grow like slowly, but make sure when people talk about you, they're like, oh my gosh, that company, instead of just rushing it. And then you're that company, which is not what you want. And then one thing I found very, very beneficial with my career path was I actually have different mentors. So I advise, don't get one mentor, get about 6. And you don't even have to tell them they're your mentor. You can actually just have conversations with them where, for example, my 6 mentors, I swear they are all above the age. They're actually different ages, but some are above 60, others are above 35. But the reason I say that is you need different advice from different people, different industries. And people give advice based on their previous experience. So my mentors will give me advice. And I ask, for example, 3 of the 6, the same question. All 3 of them will give me different answers. But I then go back and I choose what I want to apply and what I don't want to apply. Because we are still individuals at the end of the day. So you need to still make the decision that's best for you. But their guidance has honestly just like helped me grow my business and avoid certain mistakes. My one mentor, I sent her my first contract and she was just like, oh my gosh, what are you sending? She actually sat down with me and she like showed me how to write proper contracts for clients. And that was like in year one. So it's like everyone has different input, and keep those mentors around you in your life, because your life as an entrepreneur keeps changing. So the question you have 2 years ago is so different to the questions I have now. But with each of them, they're growing as well. And we just have a continuous conversation. So it doesn't have to always just end there and there. And then when in doubt, ask YouTube. So another thing I also did was rely on YouTube quite a lot, because I find that YouTube is a way to actually learn from different people from all over the world. When I was figuring out pricing and how to break down, how to make sure my website is attracting the right people, I found so many different people on YouTube also discussing that. So it's another extension for information. And also I find it's a global view. So it's always good to just see what's out there and learn something new. And another thing I do is find inspiration from entrepreneurs online. I think it's great to follow other entrepreneurs, maybe in your field, or people who you find motivate you and just have that energy around you. Because believe me, there's days where you're like, oh my gosh, do I know what I'm doing? Then there's days where you're like, oh my gosh, I'm amazing at this business thing. So you constantly, if you have people who are honest about their journey and not just glam, 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 money, 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 success, success, success. It's like you need the mixture of both. You need people who do share when it's their bad days, when they've messed up, they've lost a client, and people who are like happy to also share the success. Because for me personally, people who only share positive, it doesn't help, because you start thinking there's something wrong with you. But everyone in business, whether you sell ice cream or you have a digital agency, it will be hard. There's no such thing as a completely easy business. So never feel bad for the bad days. And then another resource I would also suggest, if you have the finances, when I first started my business, I was working from home for a good 6 to 8 months. And then I decided to get a co-working space. So a co-working space is actually a virtual, it's an office block. For example, there's the Business Exchange, there's Regis, there's WeWork. There's a whole bunch of them. You go there and you rent a desk. They start at about 1,500 rand a month. I think that is such a key thing to do at some point in your career, because I find being a business owner, I have to constantly network. I had to constantly meet people. People had to know me. People had to know what I do. And in that space, I actually then eventually picked up, oh, okay, this person in office 48 needs a new website. And because I was just there, that move actually helped me build my client base. I ended up getting so much business from the office space where I was at, because I was networking and chatting to everyone. And I also think it's just important, put yourself in a place where you constantly meet people, because as a business owner, you must always be selling. I'm always telling people what I do on a Saturday, Sunday, Monday, all the time. People know what I do, and I need to make sure of that, because that's how you actually get business. People work with people they know and like, so you need to get known. Then another thing is be willing to lose everything. One of my friends is also an entrepreneur. We always talk about how we can, in entrepreneurship, you can be doing well and things are amazing, but also the lows, you could also lose everything. So always make sure you are constantly working on your financial plan. Like, are you putting money towards a property? Are you investing in terms of equities? What is your plan? Because, for example, never have one client that is like 80% of your revenue. So if you want to have a client that's, okay, let me give you examples. If you have a client that pays you 100 rand a month, you want to make sure that you have a couple small clients that also match that 100 rand. So if you lose the 100 rand a month client, at least you still have the 80 rand a month smaller clients, for example, or maybe it's two or three others, just to make sure your portfolio is quite solid and you don't lose everything. But there's no guarantees in business, but you have to constantly be thinking, how do I make the money that's coming in today, right now, make me more money? And you can't just be stagnant and say, I'm going to be great. I'm going to be great for 20 years. You have to constantly be planning. And then it's also important just to look at future trends, like, is your business in the right space? For example, when COVID hit, for us and my type of business, it was good for us in the sense that everyone who we had quoted before, spoken to before, was like, we need a website now. And it was just a boom for us in our industry because everything went online in South Africa so quickly. Whereas before we were like asking people, please, you need a new website or you need a website. And that just helped people, COVID helped people understand the importance of digital very quickly and made people actually want our services urgently. So for us, it was a business growth opportunity. But that was also a challenge because I had to grow the team very quickly, whereas like it's nicer to grow at a slower pace so you can manage everything. But it's part of business. You have to make everything work. Then my last slide. This is my second last slide. I just wanted to share with you the clients we work with so you can also see where we are now. So we have clients such as the SABC, News Cafe, Universal Music, which I told you guys about, and Liquor City, the Consumer Goods Council of South Africa. And that's our client base. And currently our agency is a global agency because my big vision and my dream and purpose that I keep pushing is I don't want to just be a South African digital agency. I want to be a global Black-owned digital agency, and we are achieving that slowly. So we currently have an office in South Africa, and we have clients in the UK, and we have clients in the Netherlands. So we are constantly pushing to just grow beyond the borders and make sure that we have a global presence. And the last thing I want to leave you with is you can achieve anything as long as you're willing to work hard for it. I feel I have really worked hard to get to where I am. I've lost friends. I've lost lots of money. But I constantly sit back every day and think, this is where I want to be. This is what I want to do. So I will do anything to just stay on this path and keep going. So I think it's just important, figure out your goal and work on the how to get there. It's not fun. It's not always glamorous. I'm working till 2 a.m. on a Saturday or even during the week, but we have to make sure things are done. It's not always like the glam Instagram entrepreneur life, but you have those moments too. For example, I was able to work in Europe for 3 months. I was living there and then I was working on my South African clients as well while I was there. So it's the good with the bad, but it's constant hard work. You can't just give up or just be like, ugh, I don't feel like doing that. There's so many things you won't feel like doing, but you know, you actually have to. And that's it. That's my presentation in a nutshell.
Wow. Thank you. Thank you so much, Naledi. I mean, as your name says it, you're such a bright, shining star. And thanks for selflessly sharing all the nuggets and the pitfalls, the ups, the downs, the highs, the lows on your entrepreneurial journey. And I really like the questions and the comments that I've seen throughout the session, as you have triggered a lot of interest in our attendees. And in terms of the questions, I want to jump into that immediately and say, what is the difference between a business person and an entrepreneur? Is there a difference?
She say there is no difference. I think people have a personal choice because I know some people address me as a businesswoman and like a business person, and some people are entrepreneur. But I think fundamentally, you are growing a business with both terms.
cool stuff. And I think it's all in the beginning, you know, as you said, start now, you know, just start. And in your journey, in the starting phase of it, what were the challenges that you faced when starting? And the follow-up question would be, you know, capital is one of the main pieces of this big entrepreneurship puzzle. Where can one go to raise capital if one didn't have the opportunity to save while working? You know, which door do we knock at?
Okay, so for my journey, that was actually one of the reasons why I started a digital agency. So I didn't want to go the funding route. I wanted a business that I could grow myself financially. So I went the service route. So just to tell everyone, if you want to have business, you can actually grow without funding. Service is the way, because you're basically getting paid for your time. But my journey was different in that regard. But if you want to actually look at funding, another thing I'm also picking up is with funding, they still want to see proof of concept. So you have to try some form, like have a dummy project, a product or service, and then apply for funding at the IDC. There's so many different platforms, but that'll also require a business plan, and they actually consult with you on how you go about that. But yeah, it just depends on the type of business you're starting. And not all businesses need funding. For example, mine was self-funded because I focused on bringing in business. And then I got money, and then I try to make more money by bringing in more clients.
Cool stuff. And speaking of that, I mean, you've shared something very important here, that building networks also helps, you know, networking and getting a mentor or mentors also, you know, help in terms of searching for mentors. You know, sometimes we look very far for mentors and forget that maybe the people we live with under the same roof or down the road from could be our mentors. So where does one begin to search for suitable mentors? Mm-hmm.
So that's a valid point. I like that, Nati, because it's so true. Some of my mentors are my friends, to be honest. And that's how also I was saying, don't restrict it only to age, and you don't have to put a title on it. Some of my friends, for example, they work in corporate, and I asked them, they work at these organizations like yourself. I won't name them. And for example, I asked them, please read my quote. What do you think? When you guys are looking for agency, what are you looking for? What am I doing wrong? How am I supposed to talk to your procurement team? What is your business needing? And then it's like you get that type of mentorship. Some of your mentors you meet out socially, or like you said, they're your next door neighbor. Someone you can have a conversation that will help influence your business or your direction. Sometimes it's personal. I once had a mentor that literally told me, like, you need to find balance. You work too much. You actually also need to have one day a week off. Like, you can't work Monday to Monday. And that was also me understanding that as much as you want to succeed and you want to grow and grow quickly, you also need to take care of yourself. So they all share different perspectives because they know you differently, because you are different with different people. So I always say, your surroundings, your mentors are around you. Sometimes they just don't have the title.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, good stuff there. And speaking of that, you know, getting mentors and all those, building those networks, is there a book or books or even links that you can share where people can go read, click, you know, just to dig some more research so that we can empower ourselves while we're finding our way?
Oh, there's a lot. So what I can actually do is I can share also on the chat or just maybe the ebook, and then I'll just share some links because I used many different sources between books, YouTube. I also have a blog on my own website, which is at That Naledi as well. So all my social media is at That Naledi and my website. And I also just share things I've learned or where you can actually find some insights on business, mentorship, and so forth.
Cool. And one question here, I know I wouldn't be forgiven if I didn't ask this question, Naledi. As you've said, life happens, you know. Has there been a point in your journey where you thought, you know what, this is it. Where's my CV? I'm going to go find a job. This entrepreneurship thing is not for me. Icon.
Yes, definitely. So funny you asked that. It was, I must say, I think, in my first year, I had now, like, at that point, I had like a transition where, so I had lost my big client because they took social media in-house. And then the clients I had, they were like smaller clients, they weren't paying on time, they're a bit problematic. And then I was literally like in a situation where I had a car to pay for and like living expenses, like I need money. So I now was like, okay, I actually sat down and I was like, okay, I quit. I'm not going to do this anymore. Who needs to have a business? And I had a talk with myself in December because it was like the holiday. And I thought, okay, you need to decide if you go to a job, you're going to have the same issue you had before. You're frustrated. You're unhappy. If you're going to do this entrepreneurship thing, I told myself, Naledi, today you decide. You're going to stick with this, no matter how bad or hard or crazy it gets. But this whole, when things get tough, I was like, ooh, I'm just going to quit. I'm just going to go back to working. No, I decided that day, it was like December 2013 or something. And I promised myself, I was like, okay, this is hard, but I will stick through everything. And then I was like, okay, your clients right now, you're not liking your portfolio. What are you going to do about that? I actually sat and wrote down my strategy. I was like, these are the clients I want to talk to. So I remember that's when I was like, I'm going to go talk to Liquor City and News Cafe. And I just got up, dusted my feet off, and I was like, okay, go and run a business. And I went out there, spoke to those clients, and I got the business. And that was the first time I realized that my mental state and how I need to push myself is so important, because believe me, there's many times you will want to quit. But I've also come to an understanding that everything in life is hard, whether you choose a corporate career, a culinary career, an entrepreneurial career. No one has it easy all the time. Everyone, there's problems in every industry. You just need to pick the journey that's for you and be like very sure about that, because it's hard.
definitely is. Thank you so much, and thank you for not quitting as well, because had you quit, you wouldn't be sitting here listening to this inspirational journey of yours. And you know, before I let you go, Naledi, just so you know that you've mentioned about building networks, and today you have just become a lot of people's network. And even if you don't have the title, I think you've just become a lot of people's mentor. And thank you for sharing all your, you know, social media links, your blog, your contacts, because I know there will be people knocking at your door trying to pick your brains, maybe helping with writing or drafting a business plan or anything under the entrepreneurship space. So thank you for being selfless. Thank you for not giving up. And thank you for helping our young people reimagine their future. And we shall be tapping into your space, and we shall be crossing paths again. And we really appreciate your time. Right, moving right along. I did ask you to have your pen and paper ready. I did ask you to bring those calculators close by, because Claire Klassen, who manages the financial component, which is the consumer financial education space in Momentum Metropolitan, we'll be sharing some of the financial literacy nuggets. And you know, we've taught you and shared with you on how to get that job or how to be economically active. Well, it's time to know how to spend that moolah. Claire, over to you.
Thank you very much for that introduction, Inkosinati. Can we all just take a moment to appreciate our panelists? You know, the journeys that has been shared are really inspiring, and I wish you all well on your journey ahead. So, yes, Inkosinati, everybody, please grab a pen and paper and calculator, get ready. We're going to hopefully learn something. You know, I don't know if you like me, but when I see an inspiring meme, I save it so that I can share it when the moment comes up. Something that I saw recently was, don't let anyone who hasn't been in your shoes tell you how to tie your laces. And I think that is very relevant, because everybody that shared, I think over the last 3 days so far, has shared their experiences, and I'm about to do the same with you. So a little bit about myself. When I think about when I finished school, I didn't want to be a financial education specialist or manager at a corporate. I was 16 years old, and all I knew was I wanted to make a difference in my community and in the country. And I'd say about 28 years later, when I was 44 years old, I got that opportunity. I created a vision board as a part of what I want to do for the future. And one of the things I always wanted to do was go back to schools in my community and have the opportunity to talk. And I did that. The opportunity to work in CSI came up, and here I am in my current position. So I would just like to encourage everybody, find out what your inner passion is. Eventually, it will lead you to the best career you've ever had. Okay, without further ado, let me go on. What we're going to go through today is I want you to think about what do you want to get out of today, right? We're going to go through budgeting and payslips, talk a bit about needs and wants, do your own personal budget, and go through payslips and deductions on your payslip. Then we're going to go through saving for a goal, steps to saving, rules to saving and spending your money. And I've saved the best for last, which is compound interest. We're going to go through a compound interest example. Yes, I see some of you are saying you can't budget to save your life. Believe me, practice makes perfect, as with anything you go through. Do you think that the gold medalist in the swimming competition in the Olympics, she started out as the best swimmer? No, she had to practice every day. So you're going to start out with some poll questions, right? Do you want to learn how to do a personal budget? You'll have about a few seconds to complete this. And do you want to learn how to save? So please just answer yes or no for me. Okay, so yes, I'm happy to see that most of you want to learn how to do your personal budget and most of you want to learn how to save. That's awesome. So let's talk about needs versus wants. What is a need? So a need is something that you have to survive. I don't know if you have ever heard about Maslow's hierarchy of needs, but that is a need for food, shelter, love. But in financial services, we learn about what it actually entails. And then what is a want? It's something that you don't really need, but you want to have it, right? So we're just going to go through a little bit of an exercise. If it is clear, what do you think groceries is? Is it a want or a need? And you can add your answers in the chat box. What about sweets? Is it a want or a need? Beer and cigarettes? I know some of us think that beer and cigarettes is a need, but really it's more like a want. Groceries is definitely a need. School uniforms and everyday work clothes? I think it is a need. Lotto tickets. You know, what do they say? If you don't play, you'll never win, right? But what would you rather spend your money on? Lotto tickets or your future? And then fast food, is it a want or a need? School books, and in the end, life cover payments. So let me just have a look and see if anybody has answered. No, but I think it is pretty obvious what's the difference between a want and a need. So, there we see something coming through. Lotto is a want, grocery a need. Yes, beer is a want. Yes, especially after lockdown. I think everybody's going back to wanting beer. Gambling, wow, yes. Lotto ticket is a want. Thanks, guys, for sharing. Lotto ticket is your future. Okay, so budgeting and saving, turn up for what? You know, I love music, and I think the reference to it, you know, that song, Turn Up For What? So let's just do it, right? So get your pen and paper ready, guys. because we're going to do a little bit of an exercise. So if you look at the template there, on the top, we've got income. And then at the bottom, we've got expenses. Income is what do you earn? And for some of us, that can be a salary. It can be a grant. It can be a stipend if you are blessed enough to be in one of the learnerships. And then at the bottom is your expenses. And I just want you to kind of stick to the first month. Complete what is relevant to you. So my life is completely different to your life, right? And what I spend my money on is different to you, because we are only two in the house. For example, my grocery budget is only about 1,500 rand per month. If you can have a bigger grocery budget, then there's things like entertainment, if you do have money left over. But savings, we'd like to say, save at least 10% of what you earn after deductions. So yes, do you earn a stipend or an income? I don't know if any of you have answered that question in the chat function, but I'm just gonna go ahead and say complete on your piece of paper what you earn after deductions. For example, stipend of 3,600 Rand per month, please just complete that as your income. Okay, thank you for that, Amanda. You get a stipend. So just complete your stipend there on top. Essentially, your budget is your income less expenses, right? So I will leave the second and third month to you. While I'm talking, just complete all your expenses. For example, your airtime, your groceries. Do you pay for your accommodation at home? But if you're lucky enough to live with your parents and they don't ask you for money, please, when I was younger, my mother never asked me to pay for rent, but I took from my first salary that I earned, which was about 2,000 Rand at the time. I gave her 800 Rand for accommodation. So please just give your parents a little bit of what you get. If we go down, has everybody basically completed their income and roughly what their expenses are for the first month? Okay, if you can just add up your income, if you get income from selling anything, add that to your stipend amount and then add up all your expenses. And in the end, you're going to deduct your income from your expenses. And that gives you a realistic view of what you earn. After the bank charges and buying food, okay, your total expenses are 7,000 Rand. Okay, so what I want you to think about is, what do you spend your money on, right? So we're going to go through a little bit of an exercise of what your household budget looks like. Tapelo, 210 Rand every month. Thank you for that. To save money, we must basically track our spending. Riisha says, you don't have any expenses since you live with your parents. Yeah, that can be true. I know my mother used to just give me 100 Rand for nothing, just for existing. So to save money, we must track our spending. Do you know how much you spend each week? You know, if you think about it, if you go into the local Checkers or if you go to buy airtime, how much do you buy airtime? Because it's like so easy to buy airtime on your phone, right? So track how much you actually spend. The biggest tip I was ever given was, before you spend your money, ask yourself, do you need this in your life? You know, especially when you make big purchases. So what I've brought up on screen now, yes, what I've brought up on screen now is from day 1 to 5 of the week. You can use this as a template for yourself. Draw it on a piece of paper on a Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. What did you buy today and how much did it cost? So I know a tin of baked beans can go for 14 Rand, right? a loaf of bread can go for anything between 12 and 13 rand. So all of these things add up. And if you really have to go and buy McDonald's, if you compare that to cooking a meal, it's much healthier and you can buy groceries for the week instead of spending it on takeaways, right? So today, I don't know if any of you have spent anything on McD and Netflix. Have you spent any money on traveling to where you are right now? Have you spent any money today, basically? So write that in the Wednesday, and then I'd like to challenge you for the next 2 weeks or so. Write precisely what you spend your money on and see if you can do better after that 2 weeks. Because you know what? Once you know what you spend your money on, you can control your spending. And then you can have more money left over for your future self. Does it serve your purpose, your future self? Can I cook instead of buying takeaways, for example? Is it healthy? You know, we all talk about the convenience of Uber Eats. Now that we are at home, I live in a complex. And in the beginning of lockdown, I saw a lot of people just buying Uber Eats. I think it was just to help themselves feel better. But in the end, it's not healthy. And it can take a knock on your pocket, right? Petrol 350, can't ignore it because I have to drop kids off at school. Yes, absolutely. Please save your money on a daily basis so that you have enough money every month for that petrol. And in my personal circumstances, since I work from home, do I need to buy clothes as often? Or can I use that money to pay off my smallest debt? You know, electricity is expensive. Yes, Paul, definitely. I have a prepaid meter at home and I know precisely what you mean. So in the beginning of the month, I take about, let's say, 1,000 rand from my salary, and I just buy electricity because without electricity, I cannot work. Today, you spent 7 rand 50. Awesome. 100 rand. Clothes drip is forever suffering. I know, guys, but just remember that with lockdown, you don't go anywhere. So you don't really need to spend money on clothes, right? Money is too little now. The cost of living is too high. Yes, absolutely. So what has lockdown taught us? It has taught us to take a step back and see what is the stuff we really, really need to spend money on. And I challenge you to keep that going, even after, in the future, when lockdown ends one day, take those beautiful saving habits that you have had to have and take it through to your future. Payslips. I don't know how much of the audience are working, but payslips, this piece of paper is for what? I remember asking that question with my very first job that I had, which was in 1994. I've been working for 27 years, and I think I've been working for as long as most of you have been alive. I counted all the positions that I've been in over the years, and it was 20 positions. I have 21 years of experience in financial services. So yeah, let's get to what is a payslip and what do these deductions actually mean? Let me see what you guys are chatting about. You're looking for a job. Yes, please don't stop looking and take advantage of the internship programs that were shared today. We're going to go through a little bit of poll questions again. I want you to think about it, right? Is airtime a need or a want? Life cover payments and car insurance, is this a need or a want? And then do you have a budget? Do you know how much money you spend per week? So just take some time to complete that for me, please. And an interesting thing about life cover payments, it's a need and a want, depending on where you are in your life, or if you own your own vehicle, it is best to have car insurance. And if you have a family, it is best to have life insurance. Okay, the results are in. And airtime is a need for 70% of you. 30% say it's a want. Yes, I just like to talk about that. Let's say you are selling products for a living or you need to speak to people on the phone. Airtime is definitely a need if you need to be available. And if you don't need to be available on your phone, it is a want, especially if you buy more airtime that is needed. Take advantage of the free Wi-Fi. out there, because data can be really expensive. I've seen some students stand outside of buildings and surf the net with the free Wi-Fi. If you have access to that, why not? It saves you some money. And then life cover payments, yes, both. It is a need, both, because it's depending on where you are in your life stage. For example, if you have a family, a young family particularly, and you want to make sure that your kids' education or your spouse is taken care of, or the house is even paid off if you have a bond, and if you were to pass away, life insurance is a good way to do that. And car insurance, you know, 51% of you have said, if you own your own vehicle, it is best to have car insurance. And if you have a family, it is best to have life insurance. You know, it would be better if it was a bit higher. I spoke to some youngsters at a work readiness program in Cape Town. And some of them said, no, you don't need medical aid. You don't need life cover. And you certainly don't need car insurance. You know, insurance, the definition of insurance is making sure that you have something in case something happens. So we don't know whether we're going to be involved in a car accident, whether our brand new VW Polo, for example, is going to be stolen. Imagine if you just signed a loan for a car and your car gets stolen. The car insurance is there to cover that. You know, so that you don't have to end up paying for a car that you don't actually drive after it's stolen. And then 46% of you said you do have a budget, and 54% said no. I hope after today's session, you can practice, you know, the template that we had and you start budgeting. Do you know how much money you spend per week? 58% of you said no, and 42% said yes. So please track your spending, guys. As discussed, it will help you for your future needs. Payslips. How many of you have seen a payslip? I know that Naledi mentioned she uses Sage. You know, that is where payslips are done on for companies. And this is what a payslip should look like. So your name will be on the top, your ID number, your date of appointment, what is your basic salary, that is before deductions, and then if you have any additional income like overtime from the company you're working for, it will reflect there, and then tax, UIF, any deductions like funeral, pension, maintenance, and we'll talk a little bit about what these things mean. So tax and UIF, or unemployment insurance fund, is government deductions, right? Funeral and death benefit and pension deductions, those are what you call compulsory deductions. And involuntary deductions, that can be maintenance, payments for maintenance, like a garnishee order as well. Or if you haven't paid the mother of your child or father of your child or grandparents where the kid is living, any maintenance, they can go to court and, you know, get a court order. So please just make sure that you always act responsibly. Otherwise, it will come back to bite you. So government deductions, just a little bit about that. It includes things like tax and UIF. Every person who's formally employed pays 1% of their salary. In other words, 1 rand for every 100 rand you earn. This is the fund that acts as a safety net if you lose your job. So I don't know if you've seen people go to claim for unemployment. This is where they go, to the UIF. And your employer also contributes 1% of your salary towards UIF. Compulsory deductions. These are amounts that are taken off your salary, but pay for other benefits for you, like medical aid, retirement fund contributions, group insurance benefits. If you do work for a company like for Momentum Metropolitan, for example, it will go through a group scheme, and often you don't have a choice. So for me, working at Momentum Metropolitan, I have to have a medical aid, and the one that I'm on is Momentum Health. They are part of your contract of employment. So let's move on to involuntary deductions. This is typically stuff that you didn't want on your payslip, but you have to pay for, right? I remember I used to work in Momentum Investments call center, known as Momentum Wealth, and we got called to reception often for a sheriff of the court that has come to serve an order, a maintenance order, to us as an insurance company. And the reason for that is because we now become like your employer. If you are drawing down an income from your living annuity policy. So often the person didn't have a choice. We had to institute that maintenance order against the money that they have saved for their retirement. So I urge all of you to please just stick to being responsible and paying what you need to pay for, including your debts, right? Because it can also go as far as garnish your orders. And as you can see, garnish your orders comes on your payslip. So imagine you are going to apply for another job and there's a deduction for an unpaid debt that has now been handed over. Any tip? If you see your phone ringing and you think it is the debt collectors, pick it up, you know, have a conversation with them. Ask them, okay, I owe you 10,000 Rand. I currently don't work, so I can afford 100 Rand a month. Alternatively, you are working and you can only afford 500 Rand a month. Most times, 90% of the time, they will accept that from you. You know, it's always better to just have the conversation that we don't want to have about debt and pay it off as soon as possible. It will help you in your future. Budgeting means let me write down my expenses that I know I'm going to have on a monthly basis. So it's not a surprise that I need to have 1,000 Rand for electricity because I know this from the previous month. It's not a surprise that I want to save for a deposit on a car or for my education. So I set these things aside in my budget. And savings is basically what you're making a sacrifice towards for a future need. So how do you start to save? We're just going to go through saving for a goal and steps towards saving. The golden rule of saving that I want you guys to maybe write down or remember is to save at least 10% of your net income, which is income after deductions, for emergencies and towards a goal. So for some of us, we donate an additional amount of up to 10% to charity or to our religious institution. So in other words, make sure you have 10% set aside for your savings, and then anything extra you can pay towards charity or to your religious institution. People are more successful with saving. I don't know if you know this, and if you know yourself as a human being, you're more successful with saving if you have an objective in mind. So when I was listening to our previous panelist, Naledi, talk, she said she wanted to have a business, right? That was her goal. So she wanted to save towards this. So she took her bonus and she saved towards that. So I found that very, very interesting and excellent. So please have that objective in mind. In other words, you are saving for something. Use this template and set some savings goals. So if you talk about short, medium, or long-term goals, right? Picture in your mind, what is it that you want? And then let's say you want a car, right? Because you need a vehicle to travel to work. Think about whether this is a short-term goal. Is it affordable, something that I can save for in the next 2 years? So short term is immediate to 2 years. An example can also be you want to earn a certificate in a skill, you want to reduce your debt, especially your credit card. Please clear that debt as soon as possible. Deposit towards something you want. Keep track of your spending. And what you can also do is how to budget. Set that as a short-term goal. A medium-term goal is anything from 2 to 10 years, and that can be a deposit on a car or a home or a place in an estate, if you are that blessed to be able to save for that, pay off your student loan. Because if you don't pay off your student loan, it's going to hound you years, you know, like 5 years from now. Try and pay as much as you can towards your debt or saving towards a wedding. So anything from 2 to 10 years is a medium-term goal, and a long-term goal is anything beyond 10 years, like retirement or saving for your child's education, paying off your bond or car loan, and yes, starting a business. So once you know what you want to save for, right? Write on the piece of paper, how much will that cost you? So what is the price of that item? And write down what you can afford to save every month. And then you'll have enough in these many months. So let's say, for example, the car that you want to buy is 50,000 Rand and you can save 5,000 Rand a month. That means in 10 months' time, you'll have enough to buy that car cash. And then you don't have to sign for a loan to pay, you know, to pay off a vehicle. And you can apply this rule to anything. And I mean anything, even those flashy clothes or that Gucci pair of sneakers that you might want to buy. Hopefully you want to save towards your education. So do some research and see how much a degree in a specific field is going to cost you and work it out. You'll make it a reality, believe me. And there are three golden rules that I found. Do not spend more than you make. So if you earn 10,000 Rand a month, don't spend 12,000 Rand, because what does that mean? You'll have to loan 2,000 Rand just to make it, right? Number two, always plan for the future, right? So that you know, I need to have this money, this amount of money for my goal. And then number three, help your money grow. What that means is, again, when a lady was sharing, she invests in property or investments. And, you know, you can help your money grow that way by having a interest earned on an annual basis in your investments. And we'll talk a little bit about that more when we go to compound interest. Steps to saving. Choose a savings goal. I think we've been through that. Draw up a savings plan. Plan how you're going to do this, and how you practically can do that is, okay, I need to pay this. Let me budget so that I can have the amount I need on a monthly basis or an annual basis towards my goal. Know the difference between needs and wants. That's the rule number, first thing that you need to do, so that you know how to spend your money. Control your spending and think about the future. Money in, money out. Do not have more money out than what you're getting in. And you can also support your income by selling something. You know, the point was made, just start. You know, entrepreneurship can seem daunting, but if you are lucky enough to have a job, start something on the side. They call it a side hustle, and boost your income. Save regularly. Don't skip a month. So the key to doing that is to save your money in a safe place. You, most banks have a banking app now, where you can open up a separate bank account. And then on payday, you can schedule 10% at least, or if you can't afford 10%, even 100 Rand. 100 Rand per month is going to add up. At the end of the year, you'll have 1,200 Rand. So that is 1,200 that you didn't have before. Yes, open up a separate savings account from your transactional account. And what that means is you go to Checkers, right? And you have a debit card. So you're going to spend that money on basic necessities. Open up a separate savings account. And make sure that the fees are not high. Make sure that your bank can accommodate even 25 Rand in that savings account. But save you must. So this is just an image for you to to see there are seven steps towards saving. There's what you call a 70% rule, right? I don't know if you've heard about this, but I did some research and it's basically 70% is for monthly expenses. And this is anything you spend your money on, whether it's transport, groceries, electricity, airtime, a pair of socks, clothes, a spa treatment. And then 20% goes into savings, unless you have a pressing debt, in which case it goes towards the debt first. Because remember, if you don't have debt, you'll have more money left over to save, right? And then 10% goes towards a donation or tithing or your investment, retirement, savings for college, university, or online courses. So if you're earning a stipend of 3,600 Rand, 10% of that is 360 Rand. So you can take your calculator and calculate what is 10%. And that 360 Rand then goes towards investing in yourself. A pressing debt is anything urgent, expensive debt that is hurting your credit and costing you loads of interest. So if you did make a loan and the interest is, let's say, 25%, pay that off first so that you can have that money free for your expenses or your savings. So namely credit cards and loans, you know. Always seek the advice of a registered financial advisor and do your research. So what I mean by that, guys, is I know that as a university student or any learner, when you finish, you can get a bunch of people coming to you wanting to give you financial advice before you even earn your first salary. Yes, that is a good idea, but make sure that when you sit down with this person explains everything to you. In other words, what are the fees going to be? What are the administration fees going to be? Right, they want you to invest 1,000 Rand. 2.5% of that is going to go towards fees. So what does that mean? 2.5% less. That means 97.5% of my 1,000 Rand is going to go towards the investment. And then there's going to still be his 5% or 4% commission. Then you will begin to see what is the real amount that I'm investing here. And is this product that he's telling me about, is it necessary for me right now in my life stage where I am at? I don't have four kids at home, so maybe life insurance isn't a good idea for me right now. I don't have a bond that I'm paying off, so maybe that is not a good idea, but I do need maybe a funeral policy, and I do need to think about my retirement right now with my first salary. So things like that, do your investigation before you sit down with these people. They are professionals, and we want to help you succeed, so financial advisors are not always out to seek commission. There are very good financial advisors out there, and do your research and talk to as many as you can to gauge it for yourself. So the source of this is right at the bottom there, as you can see. If we move on. Here we're going to talk about the magic. The magic really happens when you understand the power of compound interest. So I don't know if you've ever heard of simple interest versus compound interest. All it is it's going to show you the money in a couple of years' time, right? What is compound interest? It's the result of reinvesting the interest rather than paying it out. So for example, I invested 1,000 Rand for the year. After the year, the interest is 10%. That means 100 Rand. I can either access that 100 Rand or I can leave it, which is a very good idea. That means in the second year, I start with 1,100 Rand. And then I add my 1,000 Rand to that. And guess what? I'll have 2,100 Rand the next year. And so on. So the sooner you start, the more you can save by the time you retire, for example. And I know that there are many 45-year-olds, even 35-year-olds saying, I wish I had started sooner. And I know that you have probably heard this from someone before, because the sooner you start, the better. So I'm going to give you a real example, guys. If you save 400 Rand per month, that is 4,800 Rand per year, which is 400 times 12. If you take your calculator, you'll see it equals that. With earning an estimated return of 10% per year, after 40 years, meaning by the time you're 65, if you are now 25, it will surprise you. So after 10 years, contributing 48,000 Rand, having an estimated 10% per year of interest, just leaving it alone will give you 84,150 Rand. And then after 20 years, if you were to contribute 96,000 Rand, guess what? You would have managed to save 302,412 Rand per year for that period. And then after 30 years, when you contribute 144,000 Rand, that number increases exponentially to 868,528. And the last example I'm giving for you is after 40 years, you contribute 192,000. And that means you have saved a whopping 2.3 million Rand. So year, 4,800 Rand is a yearly contribution. And it shows you in the end, you'll manage to save 2.3 million. And this you can apply to anything that you want to save for. A car, a house, anything really. So I hope you saw the magic there, guys. I just want to share a little bit about what we do, our financial education programs. We have three face-to-face and four digital financial education programs that we offer under Momentum and Metropolitan. Due to COVID, we've had to switch to digital programs and place our face-to-face ones on hold. We offered digital for 2021, and we managed to reach about 25,900 participants. We've invested over 10 million Rand in this. And to get a glimpse into just one of our programs, I'd like to invite you to take down this link, which I think will be shared in the chat. If you want to visit the Metro Kickstars Facebook page, there you can discuss entrepreneurship and have access to resources with like-minded individuals. We currently have 458 members. It's open to the public. Please go on there. You won't be sorry. Look out for our 2022 digital financial literacy programs on our social media. We run campaigns during our rollouts where you can win awesome prizes. And on an annual basis, we also partake in Money Smart Week South Africa that happens in March of every year. So the next one's going to happen in the last week of March 2022. I look forward to seeing you there. I just want to leave you with a quote from Warren Buffett, who's known as the ninth wealthiest person in the world. Do not save what is left after spending, but spend what is left after saving. So what that really means is don't spend money for now, rather save for your future. And if you want to hit me up, there's my LinkedIn details and Twitter handle. Thank you very much. I'd like to hand over back to my awesome colleague, the maestro of today, Nkosinati Mashlangu.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much, Claire. You've put everything so clearly. And now we do understand the rands and the cents. And yeah, I think this is one thing that Momentum Metropolitan keeps on doing, as we are a financial services institution. So we do make sure that we educate our communities about, you know, financial literacy and basic financial management tools. So ladies and gentlemen, fellow young people, it's been a great, great 4 days. We've absorbed a lot. I mean, I backtrack remembering from job seeker's guide. We looked at job seeking tools or job searching tools. We looked at coding and opportunities in further education and training. We went to skills development. We touched on nonprofit organizations that were working on upskilling young people. We talked about placements, employment, and today we came entrepreneurship, financial literacy. It's a whole lot of basket, you know, in terms of upskilling and empowering young people, helping them to reimagine their future. This is what we do as Momentum Metropolitan. We enable the life aspirations of young South Africans. So young South Africans, fellow young people, ladies and gentlemen, all our partners, all our attendees, all our presenters, thank you. Thank you so much for being part of this virtual Career Expo brought to you by Momentum Metropolitan. See you on the social media streets. Don't forget to tag us at MomMedZA, hashtag success together, hashtag MomMedCSI. It's been great. I've learned a lot, and I know you did too. So from myself, Nkosinathi Mahlangwe, and the Momentum Metropolitan crew, we appreciate you. Stay safe. Goodbye, and see you soon.
And your head don't reach the sky. Take your broken wings and fly.